The internet runs on many engines, but Nginx is the monster hiding in plain sight. Beyond the unbelievable performance, this battle-tested hero is mostly known as a web server. But that doesn't even scratch the surface. Nginx is a beast that can serve as an API gateway, content cache, load balancer, it can rewrite requests on the fly, stream media, and even serve as a mail proxy. And yes, it's probably the best reverse proxy ever built. It's not for nothing that on the last survey, on April 25, Nginx came first, serving over 33% of web servers on the internet. For proportion, on this list, Cloudflare is third. Node.js is fifth and only serves a fraction. Docker found that Nginx was by far the most commonly deployed technology in Docker containers, and since 2012, it's a core member of OpenBSD. Popularity contest aside, Nginx can serve over 10,000 simultaneous connections with an extremely low memory footprint, and I did put that claim to the test. We'll get there. Today, we're going from simple to wild, with a few surprises I never knew existed that would make any Nginx user's workflow as smooth as
coconut oil.
Born in 2002, Nginx was built by Igor Sisoev and was originally designed to solve an old problem known as C10K or 10,000 requests per second. Back in 1999, this threshold was a big deal and Nginx was there to help. But then it outgrew its original purpose, so much so that in 2011, Igor and his partner Maxim founded Nginx Inc., raising capital to provide commercial support. On 2019, F5 acquired Nginx for $670 million. And a year later, the founders left F5 with a mini drama, during which Maxim created a fork of himself by the name Free Nginx, criticizing F5. Other members of the core team created their own fork in 22, which is actively maintained and serves as a drop-in replacement. Let's dive and see what it's all about. Install Nginx if you don't have it locally. This will become handy fairly often after this video. Now, Nginx config famously lives under etc nginx or nested under a path such as mine here in homebrew. This is where nginx.conf waits for instructions. The nginx conf holds different modules controlled by directives. If you're running a simple web server, you'll need the events directive, even if empty. And HTTP is the main directive where we'll usually configure the web behavior. If it's empty, trying to launch will usually respond with what's missing. So an empty event directive is enough for us to start with all the defaults. Now, I had already added an index.html file to the default path so that when we query localhost at port 80, we're served with that. And there it is in the browser.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hey, Johnny, what's up?
Now, as mentioned, HTTP is where the interesting bits go. We'll start simple, picking a different port, which is always a good idea, not keeping local HTTP busy. Then, sending the server's name and adding a path. Let's use /temp and add a common try file, instructing 404 response if the URI or URI/index doesn't exist. This is a nice fallback or fall-through system that lets you precisely configure the behavior. Since there's nothing on /temp, we get the expected 404 page from the server. If we add an index, refreshing gets us the file. So far, easy work. But what happens when you want to serve some requests but proxy others to your backend or API or anywhere really? This is where proxy pass comes in, which is probably one of the best things Nginx is known for. A reverse proxy, something that intercepts and forwards requests and returning responses as if it handled them itself.
So we've got our Nginx server running, routing traffic, load balancing, etc. But all of this is useless without a solid DNS server that shoots the traffic at you. If you've ever handled infrastructure, you know DNS is the most sensitive piece. That's why manually fiddling with DNS records every time you spin up a new service is a huge pain and a source of drama. That's where automation comes in, and that's why I'm excited to present this video sponsor, DNSimple. If you're using infra as code tools like Terraform, and you should be, DNSimple is made for you. Not only the entire platform is built for and by developers, their Terraform provider makes managing your DNS records incredibly simple. You can define domains, records, and services right in your code. When you deploy your infra, DNS settings are automatically configured along with it. No more manual entry, no more typos, just seamless automated DNS management. Now, you may think, well, that's no different than other DNS providers, so I'm here to say, yes, it is. If you've ever touched a DNS system, you probably know how unintuitive it is and how bad the APIs are. Not here. DNSimple is built around their API. Create an account using this link and get started hosting your DNS with DNSimple's 30-day free trial. Oh, and wait, you have to get this.
Thanks to DNSimple for supporting the channel. Now, back to the video. There are a few options here. We can proxy all requests going into /secret and forward them to another server we'll configure below, listening on port 8080. To make it simple, the first block will listen on 8080, serving the welcome screen, while secret is a path that leads to another backend, in this instance something listening on another port. Run Nginx, call 8080, and we get a welcome page. If we head over to the secret path, there it is. Obviously, that's a simplification, but imagine the power of this function. I could have called a script or an external process and list as many paths as I want, controlling how they're served, what's passing through, and manipulating the response on its way back. For the sake of proof, let's have it call an external service by listening with netcat on the proxied port, calling secret now, and poof, an incoming request from Nushil and a bunch of headers. Awesome. Now you're probably thinking, that's great, but what happens when I have issues or simply want to monitor incoming traffic? This is exactly what error log and access logs are used for. Make sure they're written into a path you know. Pro tip, when replacing text that includes paths, use tildes as separators to make your life easy. One set will tail both error and access logs and call the server. Check out the registered lines, both an access entry with IP, timestamp, code, and user agent, and in this instance, connection refused registered in the error log. Now, proxying all those things is very cool, but the next thing takes matters to a whole new level. Nginx, believe it or not, is also a powerful cache on many levels. Imagine serving static content. Instead of hitting the backend again and again, you can serve cache from the disk. That's rather easy, but what about other requests? You can make it cache sub-millisecond responses so that when the scale of thousands actually hit the server, you can reduce the client's latency and protect other services. So in a way, also a small CDN. Check this out. Proxy cache enables it on the path and uses a name, my underscore cache, to define the scope, which needs to be defined above later. The validity line sets 10 minutes for upstream responses with HTTP status 200 or 302 instead of the default lifetime setting. This can be adjusted below for response code. There are additional options like adding the header to make sure it's passed on to the client. Let's start by setting all of these, and since Nginx can send requests anywhere, we'll use HTTP bin to get a dummy response and store it. curl-I gets you the headers only. There's a curl video I recommend on the channel if that's of interest. Look at the last header. The cache status says miss. This is the first time we're asking it, so it makes sense. We'll call it again and boom, hit. We can call it again and again and again. All hits. Per the config, it'll stay there for 10 minutes until refreshed. Okay, web serving, reverse proxying, caching, but man, this thing gets even better. Sometimes responses are just huge and those big packets hurt everything. Latency, network, and costs. So a natural solution is compression, and Nginx is a monster compressor. Gzip on, add it to all backends or some, pick the level of compression, 6 is a sweet spot, decide what to compress, and even pick the threshold from which packets are handled. Now, calling the large JSON endpoint with gzip header returns content with gzip under content encoding. The same request with no header isn't gzipped on its way back, but what about the size? Well, the compressed version is 400 bytes, while the one that isn't is more than 30 times larger. Crazy, isn't it? So you can proxy, serve, cache, and compress, but there's an elephant in the room we need to talk about, something Nginx is extremely well known for, mostly in the DevOps and Kubernetes communities. Can you guess what it is? Yes, Nginx is one of the best load balancers on Earth. If you go to its docs under load balancer, you'll see every communication protocol you can think of under load balancing. Starting from a simple HTTP, upstream, as shown earlier, can hold a number of backend servers. This, to Nginx, means that everything inside the backend server scope is, well, a backend server, and it'll round robin between the list with incoming requests. And while round robin is the default, you can choose a bunch of other methods, like the one with list connections, or an IP hash for sticky sessions, or just a random peek. Let's do that and test things locally, with two backends on 8181 and 2. We're expecting incoming 8080 traffic to be distributed among them. Loop through one, since netcat is done after the first request, same for the other, then we call 8080 backend path, and there is one request to 8082 and the other one to 8081, and again and again. This is where you add your strategy when needed, just pick one or Nginx will get mad. Additionally, each backend server can be given a health check configuration with attempts and timeouts, as well as wait when making decisions where to go. Okay, how about we load test this thing to see if it lives up to the hype? a small K6 script for load testing aiming at the C10K problem with 10K RPS, would run that for 60 seconds and send everything to the locally served Nginx on port 8080. It's a simple test, but nevertheless a valid one. I'll leave a linconfig with an index and let K6 start loading the system. While I fast forward with this, you'll note there's not a single error. That's not always the case. I did run many tests here and I do usually get a few failures, but never more than 0.1% at this rate. Results are in, over 500,000 requests with an average of 10K per second. Nginx is a wild beast. At this point, you're probably thinking there's nothing else this thing can do, but friends, I'm sorry, there's more, there's much more. Are you also wondering how many AWS services I just covered or killed with one technology? Here's another one. How about serving as an API gateway? Not only by manipulating requests, but also request limiting and throttling. Set a zone with number of requests per unit of time and rate, and you've got that covered too. Cool, but there's something every load balancer with an API gateway functionality needs: SSL termination. Worry not, Nginx can, and probably should, listen on 443 to serve HTTPS requests. Tell it where the certificates are held, protocols, ciphers, everything required, and let it run. I'll create a local certificate and build a small Python backend to tell me whether it can read unencrypted requests after it went through the load balancer on 443. This will be our sanity check. Now, paths are ready, Nginx started, the backend is ready to serve. Nginx T, by the way, will check whether the config file syntax and functionality are okay. HTTPS at localhost, Safari says the connection isn't private, and the reason for that is just I signed my own certificate, which no one trusts, but nevertheless, it's there. Visit the site and hello from the unencrypted backend. Amazing, SSL terminated successfully. Okay, that's enough, right? Wrong. What about streaming? Nginx has a module for streaming media. It can configure the movie's buffer size, limit the rate, stream from a certain point because the data is always indexed. But instead of demoing that, let's talk about the most common way Nginx is deployed in the wild. Containers. Docker found in 2018 that the most deployed technology, by a large margin, through Docker Hub is Nginx. It has endless flavors just on the official repo, but there's a bunch of other great repos for Nginx forks and flavors like Bitnami, Ubuntu, Rancher, VMware, Intel, CircleCI, and more. When you run it, you can use Nginx latest or go smaller with Nginx Alpine, or push things even further with Nginx Alpine Slim. Respectively, these start at 172 megabytes, then 53 for Alpine and a whopping 12 for Alpine Slim. For all that functionality, this is absolutely wild. We can run it, make sure it's up and accepting requests. There's a reason, of course, for the size. Latest comes with all the common dependencies like OpenSSL, zlib, etc., which is great for dev and staging environments, but I'll usually pick Alpine for production, which still has essential libraries, but only what's extremely important and a minimal version of each. The slim version of that removes everything, not even man pages, and while it's probably the safest option as far as security goes, it might make things hard if you're not used to stripped containers with no shell and adding libraries you know for a fact are required. I promise a surprise, Nginx is great, but you don't get much as far as visual experience go. Nginx UI is an open source, yet another web UI for the famous system. 10,000 stars and a super nice dashboard with system metrics, load network, disk IOs, served requests, per connection metrics, processes, and more. You can also visually see the listed sites or backends, physically edit configs, and view the access logs conveniently from your browser. While I'm a big Grafana user, I think this one beats it with its features. And for those of you who play a lot with Nginx config or trying to learn it, the Playground is a great online utility for that. It's built by Julia Evans, which is a very cool engineer I've been following for years. She makes these little comics, which I have on my shelf probably since 2019, and I love them. Add your config to the Playground, run it, and read the output. I think that's a lot for one session. Nginx is one of the most important building blocks of the modern infrastructure and is extremely versatile. Once you master the server, it's time to master the client. Curl is just as impressive client for requests, and much like Nginx, it does 10 times more things than you know. Check this video next to learn all about it. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.